Bismillahirrahmanirrahim. Innal hamdalillah nahmaduhu wa nasta'inuhu wa nastaghfiruhu wa nu'minu bihi wa natawakkalu alayh wa na'udhu billahi min shururi anfusina wa min sayyiati a'malina man yahdihillahu fala mudilla lahu wa man yudlil fala hadiya lahu wa nashhadu an la ilaha illallahu wahdahu la sharika lahu wa nashhadu anna muhammadan 'abduhu wa rasuluhu sallallahu alayhi wa ala alihi wa sahbihi wa sallama tasliman katheera. يا أيها الذين آمنوا اتقوا الله حق تقاته ولا تموتن إلا وأنتم مسلمون يا أيها الناس اتقوا ربكم الذي خلقكم من نفس واحدة وخلق منها زوجها وبث منهما رجالا كثيرا ونساء واتقوا الله الذي تساءلون به والأرحام إن الله كان عليكم رقيبا يا أيها الذين آمنوا اتقوا الله وقولوا قولا سديدا يصلح لكم أعمالكم ويغفر لكم ذنوبكم ومن يطع الله ورسوله فقد فاز فوزا عظيما أما بعد فإن خير الحديث كتاب الله وخير الهدي هدي محمد صلى الله عليه وسلم وشر الأمور محدثاتها وكل محدثة بدعة وكل بدعة ضلالة وكل ضلالة في النار ثم أما بعد. Alhamdulillah, brothers and sisters, we have officially sent out the announcements. Tonight will be the first night of Tarawih, inshallah. Tomorrow is the first day of the blessed month of Ramadan. Alhamdulillah, who has brought it upon us, and we ask Allah Azza wa Jal to fill it with us with safety and peace and with lots of obedience to Him subhanahu wa ta'ala, and with lessons that we take away for the rest of the year. With the month now coming, I do want to share just, you know, some last minute advice and things that we can talk about. Alhamdulillah, we had the workshop where we talked about the fiqh of Ramadan, we talked about spirituality, we talked about health, nutrition, other things related to the month. But inshallah, we have one more final opportunity to really put into our head something that will give us a plan, if we don't have a plan, for what we're going to get out of this month of Ramadan. And there are four key things that I want to just highlight, and these are four spiritual foundations that we need to have to improve our relationship with Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, to improve our practice of Islam. And these are ikhlas, which is sincerity to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, tawbah, which is repentance to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, muraqabah, which is being aware that Allah azza wa jal is constantly watching us. We are constantly under His watch. And then the final one again being taqwa, which is the actual purpose of our creation, to be obedient to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. And I just want to share a few reminders about what Allah azza wa jal tells us about sincerity and all these other things, and what the Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam told us about these things, so we can focus on these four key aspects of our spiritual foundation in the month of Ramadan. It's not just about waking up early, you know, eating your meal, trying to find it, you know, how to make it to throughout the day for these 15 and a half or 16 hours until Maghrib time. What happens in these hours when you're fasting? Focus on these four key concepts: building your sincerity, repenting to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, understanding what you're doing is a result of you being aware that Allah azza wa jal is watching you, and then being aware that in your obedience to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, you're fulfilling the main goal and purpose that Allah azza wa jal set out for all of mankind. With regards to sincerity, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala clearly tells us in the Quran, وَمَا أُمِرُوا إِلَّا لِيَعْبُدُوا اللَّهَ مُخْلِصِينَ لَهُ الدِّينَ, that they have not been commanded except to worship Allah alone, being sincere to Him in their obedience to Him, or being sincere to Him in their following of the faith. And this is what Allah azza wa jalla, as a core concept, wants from us. That when we worship Him sincerely, out of desire to worship Him, out of the need to worship Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, and not to divide our intentions with some other kind of thing. And Allah Azza wa Jalla tells us, in Eid al-Adha, the time when we sacrifice, you know, the sheep or the cow or the lamb, and we give that meat to the poor and the needy. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says about this, He says, it is not the meat of the animal that you're sacrificing, nor the blood that is spilt, that reaches Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. A concept in some other faiths or some other religions is that when you sacrifice an animal, you're sacrificing it to the God, meaning you're leaving the meat for the God. The God is going to eat this meat or whatever it is. This is not the case, alhamdulillah, this is not the case or the reality. The meat that you sacrifice, the blood that is spilled, none of that reaches Allah. What reaches Allah is your obedience, your act of submission to Him. He told you to do it and give the meat to the needy. You did it and you gave the meat to the needy. This is what reaches Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Any time you obey Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, it's not necessarily what is He getting out of it. You're getting out of it that you obey Allah azza wa jal, and that is the purpose of your sincerity. And Allah azza wa jal says, قُلْ إِن تُخْفُوا مَا فِي صُدُورِكُمْ أَوْ تُبْدُوهُ يَعْلَمْهُ اللَّهُ. Allah azza wa jal tells us that, say, if you hide or conceal what is in your hearts, or you let it be known, either way Allah is already aware of it. No matter what you do, whether you conceal the intentions that you have, whether you make them known, it doesn't matter. Allah is always, always aware of the deepest, darkest things that you have inside of you. There's nothing that is hidden from Him, subhanahu wa ta'ala. So it is better for us to be sincere in our intentions when we are worshipping Him, subhanahu wa ta'ala. So when we're thinking about fasting, when we're thinking about waking up, when we're thinking about coming to the masjid for salah, at-tarawih, and the prayer, and so on and so forth, make that intention for Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala and for Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala alone. And the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam said, إِنَّمَا الْأَعْمَالُ بِالنِّيَّاتِ وَإِلَّمَا لِكُلِّ امْرِئٍ مَا نَوَى. A famous hadith of the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, every deed is based on an intention. Whenever you do something, you have an intention behind what you're doing. And he said, وَإِنَّمَا لِكُلِّ امْرِئٍ مَا نَوَى. Every person will get from Allah whatever it is that he intended. And he referenced in this hadith a person who migrated from Mecca to Medina, this huge reward of leaving Mecca and coming to Medina, but it was lost because this person migrated only for the sake of marriage, not for the sake of supporting Islam or being with the Prophet ﷺ or the command to migrate from one city to the next. He missed out on that because his intention was different, even though the action was the same. So a person can be fasting throughout the month of Ramadan, but what is inside their hearts? What is it that they're doing this for? That is what we will get. And if we do it for Allah, then Allah Azza wa Jalla will reward us for that. And the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam said, "Inna Allaha la yanzuru ila ajsamikum wa la ila suwarikum, walakin yanzuru ila qulubikum." Wa fi riwayatin ila qulubikum wa a'malikum. The Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam said that indeed Allah does not look at your physical nature, nor does He look at your appearance. Right? He doesn't look at how you're built. He doesn't look at the kind of clothes you're wearing. He looks into your hearts, and He looks into your deeds. This is what Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is concerned with. He doesn't care how you appear on the outside, how you make yourself look. What Allah azza wa jalla looks is inside the hearts, and He looks at what you're doing with the hearts. Is it matching what you're doing with your hands? What you're doing, you're performing your deeds. So this is what Allah azza wa jalla looks at. Three important things to watch out for when we talk about sincerity. Three important pitfalls when we talk about sincerity. Number one, the hidden form of showing off. There's something the scholars describe as the hidden form of showing off. Openly showing off is different. There's a hidden form of showing off, and that is when you're concealing your good deeds. You're not doing your deeds for the sake of other people. You're doing them from Allah. You're hiding them from other people. They don't know all the good that you're doing. They don't know how many hours in the night you're praying. They don't know how many people you're helping to feed. But because of you performing good deeds, sometimes you may expect people to treat you differently. You may expect that I do this and this and this for the sake of Allah, people should, you know, recognize something about me. And this is a hidden form of showing off when you expect people to treat you better because of your ibadah to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, and we ask Allah azza wa jalla to keep us safe from that. This is a hidden form of showing off. Another pitfall is making sincerity a means, not a goal. Imam Ghazali, rahimahullah, he mentioned one time, it's not an authentic hadith, but he heard a statement that he said that whoever is sincere to Allah for 40 days, the rivers of wisdom will flow from his tongue. So Imam Ghazali was younger at that time. He started to be sincere for 40 days, and then he didn't see anything flowing from his tongue, right? He didn't see any kind of wisdom. So he complained to his sheikh, and his sheikh told him, he said, "You were sincere for the wisdom, you weren't sincere for Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala," right? Even if it was true. But making sincerity itself a goal, not thinking that, okay, I need to be sincere because of some other reason, but being sincere purely for the sake of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, not expecting anything except whatever Allah azza wa jalla chooses to give us. And number three, the third way of violating the quality of sincerity is by humiliating ourselves in front of people on purpose to show that we are humble, unnecessarily at times. Right, sometimes we'll unnecessarily over-humble, over-humiliate ourselves in front of people, break ourselves down, make ourselves feel like we're nothing in front of people to try and appease to them, to make them feel like that, oh, this person must be really sincere. And we have to be careful. Sincerity is something, as Allah Azza wa Jalla tells us, He looks in the hearts, it's found in the hearts. It's not something that can be displayed by people. You have no idea based on how somebody is acting, what somebody is saying, whether or not they're sincere. Only Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala knows whether a person is really sincere or not. And the person themselves, if they're true to themselves, they know whether or not they're sincere to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. But nobody else can tell. So there's no need for us to overly humiliate ourselves and, you know, make ourselves appear to be in some form or fashion where people will think that we are sincere in our actions. We ask Allah Azza wa Jalla to protect us from all these types of acts which could fall under hypocrisy. Wal'iyadu billah. That's when it comes to sincerity. The next portion we want to focus on in the month of Ramadan is repentance. The Prophet ﷺ said, whoever fasts the month of Ramadan, right? Imanu wahtisaba, that with true faith and keeping account of his fast, whoever stands in the nights of Ramadan, in the night prayer, imanu wahtisaban, he will be forgiven, ghufira lahu ma taqaddama min dhanbihi, all of his sins that came before, he will be forgiven for. So one of the main reasons Allah gave us Ramadan is to be forgiven for our sins. So repentance is a major component that we have to have in the month of Ramadan. Tawbah or repentance, it means to turn to Allah and turn away from disobedience to Allah. And there are three main components when it comes to making tawbah or turning to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. The first one is, if you're still engaged in a sinful act, to stop. If you're engaged in something you know you shouldn't be engaged in and you recognize it in the moment, you stop. The second thing is to have regret in your heart that you did it in the first place. An-nadmu huwa at-tawbah, regret itself is repentance, is the essence of repentance. If you're not sorry for what you did, you're not really sorry. And we know that. We can fake apologies, we can fake sorries. If you don't mean it, you're not really sorry. So you have to regret the fact that you were engaged in something that was sinful or that was not pleasing to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala in the first place. The third, be determined not to do it again. Have this azm, this determination that I'm not gonna go back and do this again. Right? These are the three main components of repentance. And there's a fourth one, if you hurt somebody else. These three are if the sin is between you and Allah. The sin is between you and Allah, these three are sufficient. There's a fourth one if other people are involved. So you talked about somebody, you ruined somebody's reputation, you messed with somebody else's life, you took a right away from somebody else. The fourth condition that applies for your repentance to be accepted is you have to make right with the person that you wronged. If you took something away, you have to give it back. If you violated their honor, you have to apologize. If you took advantage, you have to give them back what they deserve and you have to apologize. These are the components of tawbah, and we have to understand this fourth one. When we are wronging each other in regards to each other's rights, that tawbah is not complete. Repentance is not complete unless we make right with each other. And Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala has told us in the Quran, وَتُوبُوا إِلَى اللَّهِ جَمِيعًا أَيُّهَا الْمُؤْمِنُونَ لَعَلَّكُمْ تُفْلِحُونَ. Repent to Allah, all of you, those who believe. Repent to Allah, why? So that you will be successful. This mercy of Allah is what we need. The mercy is really what we're looking for, and you want that success to get the mercy of Allah, then repent. تُوبُوا إِلَى اللَّهِ جَمِيعًا أَيُّهَا الْمُؤْمِنُونَ لَعَلَّكُمْ تُفْلِحُونَ. The Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam said, وَاللَّهِ إِنِّي لَأَسْتَغْفِرُ اللَّهَ وَأَتُوبُ إِلَيْهِ فِي الْيَوْمِ أَكْثَرْ مِنْ سَبْعِينَ مَرَّةٍ وَفِي رِوَايَةٍ أَكْثَرْ مِنْ مِئَةٍ مَرَّةٍ. The Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam himself, who is our example of righteousness and piety, he said, I swear by Allah that I myself ask Allah for forgiveness over 70, or in one narration, over 100 times a day. We know our Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam is not in need of seeking the forgiveness of Allah. Allah Azza wa Jalla has His protection for our prophets. But our Prophet ﷺ is doing is teaching us what we need to be doing on a daily basis. He's showing us, look, I seek the forgiveness of Allah over 70 to 100 times a day. So what should we be doing? Minimum, at least that same amount, because He is teaching us, He's giving us an example, sallallahu alaihi wasallam. So in the month of Ramadan, find opportunities to seek the forgiveness of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. It's as simple as being aware that you're seeking forgiveness and asking Allah to forgive and pardon us. Just being aware and asking Allah to forgive and pardon us. And that exercise will remind you of what you're seeking forgiveness for. Sometimes you don't know. Sometimes we're too arrogant. I didn't do anything today. I didn't hurt anybody. I didn't have any sins. But you sit down and you start seeking the forgiveness of Allah. Oh Allah, I'm sorry, astaghfirullah, astaghfirullah, wa atubu ilayh, astaghfirullah min kulli dhunub, I seek forgiveness for all my sins. You will see, just that exercise, Allah will remind you what you need to seek forgiveness for. And that will become a more spiritual, a more emotional exercise than you can imagine. Sitting down, finding space, and really seeking forgiveness from Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. And the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam said, Allahu afrahu bitawbati abdihi min ahadikum saqata ala ba'irihi wa qad adallahu fi ardin falat. That Allah is more happy. Allah is more happy than any one of you when you repent, when one of His servants repents, than someone who would have lost his camel in the middle of the desert and all of a sudden find it. Why did He give this example? When the Arabs would travel in the desert, all of their supplies would be on their camel. All of their supplies are on their camel. And if that camel runs away, they're left in the middle of the desert to die with nothing, right? And so what would happen if that was your situation? You're traveling, you're in the middle of your desert, all of your supplies are on this camel, and then the camel takes off and runs away, and then you can't go after it, you can't find it, and you're left in the desert to die. And you're just waiting, and all of a sudden it comes back to you, and you see it with all your supplies, your water, you're already thirsty, you're already hungry, you have a way to go home. How happy would you be that your life is now being saved? And the Prophet ﷺ tells us, Allah is even more pleased, is even more happy when one of you turns to Him in repentance. SubhanAllah. How pleased do we make Allah Azza wa Jal by admitting our faults and turning to Him and asking forgiveness? He is happier than one of us would be if we found an opportunity to save our lives on the brink of death. He is more pleased with us at that moment when we are seeking repentance from Him, subhanahu wa ta'ala. So we should be doing this on a more regular basis. And the Prophet ﷺ told us, إِنَّ اللَّهَ تَعَالَى يَبْسُطُ يَدَهُ بِاللَّيْلِ لِيَتُوبَ مُسِيءُ النَّهَارِ وَيَبْسُطُ يَدَهُ بِالنَّهَارِ لِيَتُوبَ مُسِيءُ اللَّيْلِ حَتَّى تَطْلَعَ الشَّمْسُ مِنْ مَغْرِبِهَا. Our Prophet ﷺ told us the beauty of the mercy of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, that Allah Himself extends His hands out in the evening for those who sin during the day. And He extends His hand out in the daytime for those who sinned in the night. Meaning He is always, always there. His hand is outstretched. He's waiting for us to reach out to Him and repent and seek forgiveness. And He is going to have mercy on us. This is a promise from Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. All He's doing is waiting. He's waiting for us to go and repent and turn to Him subhanahu wa ta'ala. And in this beautiful month where we have the opportunity to have all of our previous sins forgiven, how often should we be going out and looking for the hand of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala when He's waiting for us to go to Him? And how embarrassing is it for us to now know that Allah Azza wa Jalla in the daytime is there waiting for us? Are you coming? Are you seeking forgiveness? And in the nighttime, Allah Azza wa Jalla is there waiting for us. Are you going to ask forgiveness? I'm here. I'm waiting for you. And then we don't go to Him subhanahu wa ta'ala. This is something we should be ashamed of when we ask Allah Azza wa Jalla to forgive us and pardon us for that. The third main thing we need to remember in the month of Ramadan is muraqabah, meaning that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is always, always, always watching us. And what this essentially means is whether or not we are aware at times that we are under the supervision of God, that we are being watched by Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, regardless of our awareness of that or not, Allah Azza wa Jal is always watching. And He is always seeing us and He is always recording us. And this mindfulness, this awareness that Allah is always watching us, is what keeps us in line. If we are aware of that, we know that this will keep us in line. And it's as simple as understanding how you behave when you're pulling up to a stop sign and there's a police officer waiting on the side of the road. Right? When you know someone is watching, you're going to make a full stop, not a California stop. Right? You're going to make a full stop. And because you know that officer is there watching. Sometimes now, mashallah, I don't know, Alpharetta, the police officers, they leave their cars with nobody inside. Have you seen that? All the brake lights hitting when the people are going down the road, everybody's stopping at the stop sign until you realize there's nobody in the police car, then they take off again. But the idea of being under supervision is what keeps us as human beings in check. And so at a spiritual level, when you get to that realization that Allah is always watching, He is always watching, right? That is something that helps you in the long run to maintain your behavior and your character as a good person. Because you're always under supervision. You want to undercut somebody, you want to take advantage of somebody, you want to lie about something, right? When you realize, well, I am under watch. I am under Allah's supervision. If I do this, I'm caught. I'll be questioned for this on the day of judgment. I'm going to be held accountable for this. This is what's going to help you mold and form your character. On the other side, now think about how we behave sometimes when we misbehave with other people or with ourselves. And how are we ignoring the fact that we are being watched by Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala? Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala tells us, إِنَّ اللَّهَ لَيَخْفَ عَلَيْهِ شَيْءٌ فِي الْأَرْضِ وَلَا فِي السَّبَاءِ. That Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says, indeed, to Allah, nothing is hidden, neither in the earth nor in the skies. There's nothing that is hidden. And Allah Azza wa Jal even tells us that, هو الذي خلق السماوات والأرض في ستة أيام ثم استوى على الأرش يعلم ما يلج في الأرض وما يخرج منها وما ينزل من السماء وما يعرج فيها وهو معكم أينما كنتم والله بما تعملون بصير. It is He who created the heavens and the earth in 6 days and then established Himself above the throne. He knows what penetrates into the earth and what emerges from it. Every single seed that goes into the ground, Allah knows every single seed that goes into the ground. Every single plant that is coming up from between the earth and the soil, Allah is aware of every single one of those things. And He said, and He knows what comes, descends from the heavens and what ascends therein, and He is with you wherever you are, and Allah is entirely of what you do, seeing. He is watching, seeing everything that you do. He knows every single seed, every single plant, every single leaf that falls from a tree, because this is His power, this is His nature, subhanahu wa ta'ala. So imagine the kind of stuff that you do and that the kind of stuff that you say. Every single thing, even وَلَقَدْ خَلَقْنَا الْإِنسَانَ وَنَعْلَمُ مَا تُوَسْوِسُ بِهِ نَفْسُهُ. Allah Azza wa Jalla tells us that we made you. I'm the one that made you, and I know what you whisper to yourself. The things, the thoughts that you tell yourself in your head, when something happens and the things, sometimes we behave some way with one person and on the inside we're thinking something else. Allah is saying, look, I made you. I formed you. I put you into this situation. I created you essentially in everything around you. I know even what you whisper to yourself. Allah has access to everything that He created. Even our thoughts and the things that we say, the things our hearts feel and say to ourselves, and we have to be more aware of that. And Allah Azza wa Jalla tells us, أَمْ يَحْسَبُونَ أَلَّا نَسْمَعُ سِرَّهُمْ وَنَجْوَاهُمْ بَلَا وَرُسُلُنَا لَدَيْهِمْ يَكْتُبُونَ. He said, do they actually think that we can't hear their secrets and that we can't hear their private conversations? Those things that you have in secret with one or two other people that are not probably about good things. He says, look, we know what your secrets and we even know your private conversations. But he goes beyond that. He says, بَلَا وَرُسُلُنَا لَدَيْهِمْ يَكْتُبُونَ. We even have messengers, angels, that are writing, recording everything that you're doing. So not only is Allah Azza wa Jalla himself aware, there's also evidence that's being recorded against every little thing that we're saying and every little thing that we are doing. And the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam said, اتَّقِ اللَّهَ حَيْثُمَا كُنْتَ وَاتْبَعِ السَّيِّئَةِ الْحَسَنَةَ تَمْحُهَا وَخَالِقِ النَّاسَ بِخُلُقٍ حَسَنٍ. The Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam said, be aware of Allah, be obedient to Allah wherever you are. And if you ever mess up, you do something bad, follow it up with something good. Right, this is the nature of human beings, this is how we are. We will forget that Allah Azza wa Jalla is watching us, we will slip up. But how do you solve that? He says, if you do something bad, follow it up with something good, and it'll wipe out the bad that you did. And treat people, وَخَالِقِ النَّاسَ بِخُلُقٍ حَسَنٍ. And then he gives us an example of something good that you can do to help wipe out the bad that you did. وَخَالِقِ النَّاسَ بِخُلُقٍ حَسَنٍ. Treat people with good character. When you meet people, treat them with good behavior, with good character. This is something good we can do to wipe out the bad that we do. And the last and final thing, brothers and sisters, is understanding that the whole month of Ramadan, we're trying to build taqwa of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, and taqwa essentially is being in a state of obedience to Allah azza wa jal as much as we possibly can. Being in a state of obedience as much as we possibly can. So he tells us, يَا أَيُّهَا الَّذِينَ آمَنُوا كُتِبَ عَلَيْكُمُ الصِّيَامُ كَمَا كُتِبَ عَلَى الَّذِينَ مِنْ قَبْلِكُمْ لَعَلَّكُمْ تَتَّقُونَ. Fasting is prescribed on you. Those who believe, fasting is prescribed upon you as it was made obligatory upon nations before you for the purpose of you having this consciousness of God, this obedience to God subhanahu wa ta'ala. And then Allah Azza wa Jalla also tells us, يَا أَيُّهَا النَّاسُ اُعْبُدُوا رَبَّكُمْ الَّذِي خَلَقَكُمْ وَالَّذِينَ مِنْ قَبْلِكُمْ لَعَلَّكُمْ تَتَّقُونَ. A message that goes out to all of mankind. Two types of khitab, two types of addresses in the Quran. Number one, when Allah Azza wa Jalla says, يَا أَيُّهَا الَّذِينَ آمَنُوا, where He's addressing the people who believe with some kind of command. And there's يَا أَيُّهَا الَّذِينَ كَفَرُوا, sorry, there's three or there's more, right? Those who disbelieve. And then there's one that's for all of mankind. For all of mankind. And He says, يَا أَيُّهَا النَّاسُ, O people, every single person, regardless of whether you believe or you don't believe, whatever it is, اُعْبُدُوا رَبَّكُمْ, worship your Creator, worship your Master, the one who created you, the one who created those who came before you from generations ago, the one who will continue to create people from generations to come. Why? لَعَلَّكُمْ تَتَّقُونَ. So that you can attain this consciousness of God. So you can attain this connection with Him subhanahu wa ta'ala and be obedient to Him subhanahu wa ta'ala. This is our goal in the month of Ramadan. Inshallah, just quick recap, building up our sincerity, repenting to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala as much as we possibly can, because we know He's waiting for us to come to Him, being aware of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, developing this quality of knowing that we are constantly under His watch, that His angels are watching us and recording, and building up the obedience and building up our capacity to obey Him as much as we possibly can, as much as we know that we possibly can. Subhanahu wa ta'ala, to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, aqulu qawli hadha wa astaghfirullah li wa lakum wa li sa'iril muslimina min kulli dhanbin fastaghfiruhu innahu huwal ghafurur rahim.